Criminal media's Polity Amtabi Madiba author Kerise Anderson discusses a book titled Intelligent Isn't Enough, A Black Professional's Guide to Thriving in the Workplace. Your book is a Black professional's guide to standing out at work. You have worked for over 17 years with top companies in South Africa and abroad. What have you noticed is the most common issue young Black professionals are faced with in the workplace?
Well, I mean, a lot of it, I think, starts with the title of my book. A lot of young people feel like, well, once I get the qualifications, I get the degree, I get the certification, I'm set for life. And that's honestly just not the case. While we appreciate the degrees and the qualifications and the certifications, I think they are, you know, 30%, probably even less of what it will take for you to be successful. So I think that's number one. And I think that feeds into my second thought on that, which is just the importance of other people, the importance of relationships. Because if you recognize that your degrees are not the be all end all in terms of you being successful, you know, you're going to recognize that you need other people. You need to build relationships with your manager, with mentors and sponsors. I mean, I mentioned a formula in my book called 70-20-10, which is basically saying that, you know, in order to become a leader, 70% of your training, right, is about on-the-job experiences. 20% is about learning from other people. So managers, mentors, sponsors, coaches. 10% is formal training. So if you think about it, we're coming in with 10% of the formal training. We're not coming in with the other 90%. That's going to come from people and people giving us opportunities. So I think that's another one. I would say maybe a third one is this concept around authenticity. So I hear a lot of young people say, well, you know, I'm not going to be fake and I'm, you know, I'm either going to be 100% real or I'm 100% fake. And I want people to understand that I speak about this concept in my book where I call it the continuum of authenticity. You know, where it's not about my authenticity is one thing or the other. It's either I am or I'm not, but I think there's a spectrum of authenticity. And we have to figure out based on our context, our audience, and the message that we're trying to get across, where do we want to play across that spectrum? All the while still being some form of our authentic selves. And I say in the book, you know, if I'm with my family and friends, I'm going to be probably Kerise on level 10. I can't be that way in an interview. Right? Because people are going to be like, this girl's crazy. She's loud. She's cracking jokes. She's sarcastic. It's just not going to be appropriate for that audience because they don't know me. Right? So when I'm at work, I'm going to still be some version of myself. It might just be a little bit toned down, you know, so that I can be effective, so that I can have impact. It's not just authenticity for authenticity's sake. What I say in the book is if my family were to come to work, would they recognize me? They might say, okay, Carrie, I see Carrie. She's a little toned down, but I still see her in there. If my work colleagues were to come to my home and see me with my family and friends, would they recognize me? You know, so it's not about being two different people. It's about just operating on that spectrum and finding how can I be authentic in a way that still allows me to be effective and have impact based on the audience, the context, and the message. So I'll leave it at those three for now.
And you emphasize the point that work is not like school. Tell us more about that.
Well, I mean, I think about my own school career. I never really had relationships with professors and I graduated cum laude from undergrad. You know, it is possible to not have any relationships in university and still be really successful. That is not the case at work. You have to have relationships with people in order to be successful, to know what it is that you're doing, to know how that place works, how to be successful in that space, and ultimately how to advance. You cannot do it alone. You can do school alone. I did school alone, so that is possible. I think the other thing about school is you're very aware of when the tests are. You know, you get that syllabus at the beginning of the year. You know what is comprising your grade, if it's like this exam or this paper. Every now and again, the professor will get you with a pop quiz. For the most part, you kind of know, you know, when you need to show up at your best in order to do well in that class. Work is not like that. I mean, the tests are every day, you know, and you don't know what, a lot of times you don't even know what you're being graded on. You know what I mean? Because you're still trying to figure these spaces out. And that's why we need people to coach us and to mentor us and to sponsor us, you know, so that we can be successful in those spaces. I think those are probably my two biggest differences between work. And I mean, I also think, you know, work is you have a lot less control over your work situation than you do at school. If I don't like a class, if I don't like a professor, I can drop it, you know, and maybe take it the next semester, take it with a different professor. Work is not like that. You kind of got to stick it out until you go somewhere else. You know, you don't get to choose the people that you work with, you know, and I know sometimes in school, you don't necessarily get to choose who you're on a group project with, but it only lasts for a semester. You know, you're like, if I can just endure these people for the next X number of weeks, and then I never have to look at them again. Work is not like that. You've got colleagues, you got to keep working with them. Even if you don't like them, if they don't like you, you don't get along, you got to figure it out. You got to work your way through it, because until you leave that job or leave that company, you have to learn how to work with those people. I think those are some of the biggest differences between work and school.
And in your book, you argue that many young Black professionals struggle early on their careers as they lack the necessary soft skills to successfully navigate their work environments and reach their full potential. So what do you think young professionals need to relook at and rectify?
Well, I think a lot of it goes back to your first question, recognizing that my degrees are not enough. So I have to learn how to build relationships with people in a professional setting. I've got to learn how to work through conflict and differences. And those are the skills that I think a lot of us don't have, because no one has ever emphasized those to us. I feel like, you know, in Black culture, and I'm speaking broadly, I feel like there's such an emphasis on degrees. There's no, you know, and people tell you, go out there and be successful and be excellent. But nobody ever says you have to be excellent with, through, and for other people. Your excellence does not exist in a vacuum. Think about it. You know, I'm sure you have siblings. I have siblings. I have a brother and a sister. Now, we grew up in the same household. We grew up, you know, pretty much with the same values. And sometimes we don't get along. We share DNA and we don't get along. So imagine when you go to work, you're working with people who you don't share DNA with, you don't share values with, you didn't grow up in the same household. So there's going to be conflict. So how do you work your way through that conflict? I think a lot of us are very ill-equipped to deal with that. And I also think even building relationships. I've had a lot of people ask me questions like, how do I build a relationship at work? I was like, well, how do you build a relationship in your personal life? You get to know people, you talk to people, you ask, you know, Tabi, what are you interested in? What do you like to do for fun? Like, we talk like regular people, and we need to do the same thing at work, obviously with boundaries, right? We can't go too far into people's business if they're not comfortable sharing, but we just need to find some way to share things about ourselves that have nothing to do with work. Because, you know, you become like a robot if all people know about you is your work product. People are really going to trust you. They have to know something about you besides what is on your CV or what skills you bring to the table. And I think those are the sorts of things that sometimes trip us up. I also think some of the advice we get from our well-meaning Black parents and friends and family, you know, things like, well, don't tell those people your business at work because they'll use it against you. Those people are not your friends. You didn't go to work to make friends. Put your head down, work hard, and you'll be recognized. Like, that kind of advice. Think about it. People factor nowhere in that advice. It's solely about self, and that's not how you're going to be successful at work.
And can you briefly explain to us the difference between working in your career and working on your career?
Sure. So working in your career is really about, you know, let's say, for example, I had a cookie shop. Working in my business is buying the ingredients for my cookies, mixing up my cookies, selling my cookies, delivering my cookies to my customers, right? That's working in my business. And this is a term from the entrepreneurial world. Working on my business is taking a step back and saying, am I selling the right things to the right people at the right time, in the right places, at the right price points? Is when you take a step back and you're asking yourself these larger questions to see if your business is moving in the right direction. And then I realized it's the same thing with our careers. We work in our careers. That's me doing my job every day, you know, producing whatever outputs I'm supposed to produce. Am I developing at the right pace? Am I developing the right skills at the right time? Am I building the right relationships? Do I have mentors? And more importantly, do I have sponsors? You know, so it's asking those larger questions that have an impact on your career.
Talk to us more about why it's critical for one to understand their why if they want to make peace with the sacrifices they will eventually have to make to achieve their goals.
I think the concept of your why is, why did you come to this company? What made you choose this company over another one? what made you decide that this was the right place for your for you to be right now? And I think, you know, what are the skills that you want to develop? What are the what's the kind of impact you want to have? What are the relationships you want to be able to build? So you need to have that why in place, because sometimes you might have to make sacrifices. You might have to work late. You might have to work on the weekends. You might have to give up time with family and friends or your significant other. And if you're always feeling like, well, I'm just doing this for company A, B, and C, I think that starts to build resentment and bitterness because you feel like you're just doing this for someone else. But when you realize, no, I'm sacrificing this in the short term, maybe for company A, B, C, but ultimately this is serving my purposes. It's not just serving the company. And so that's why it's important to have that why, because it helps you make peace with some of those sacrifices that you have to make.
And in just a short explanation, please highlight the three frameworks for evaluating culture, which individuals should explore at their organizations.
You know, the whole concept of cultural intelligence is being able to understand and function in a culture that is different than your own. And a lot of times when we go into a corporate, it is very different from our culture. We've grown up in a very kind of community, collective, you know, culture. And then you go into a corporate and it's very individualistic. It's very much about self. And that's why, you know, I think sometimes we struggle to brand ourselves because it feels like arrogance. And it goes against how we've culturally been raised, right? We weren't raised to just talk about me, 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 me. It was more about we. And so I think trying to understand, okay, what is the culture of this organization? What is my own personal culture? And how do I find ways to merge the two in a way that doesn't violate my boundaries? And so I think a lot of times young people will go into a space and, you know, they assume that this organization is going to work the way that they work, or that the culture of that organization is similar to their culture. And then they get very, very frustrated. And I know I did too. I was very frustrated at some of the places I've worked. But what I'm trying to really impress upon people is understand how this company operates, because ultimately that's what you were drawn to. You were drawn to how the place works because that's what built that brand. And so you, before going in and judging organizations or judging cultures, I think we need to really understand, why does this place operate the way that it operates? And does it violate my values to operate in the same way? I mean, one of the examples I give in the book is McKinsey has a very top-down communication style. So the top-down communication style is basically, I say the most important thing, the thing that will hook you, and then I give you the detail. A lot of us communicate from a bottom-up perspective though. So we give you all the details, and then we hit you with the big so what. But that's not how they communicate there. And the reason they do that is because, you know, they're oftentimes working with C-suite executives who don't have a lot of time. So you need to get their attention first and then you give them the detail. And so there's a method to why they communicate the way that they do. But if you just look at it off the top and you're saying, I'm frustrated, I don't want to communicate this way, then, you know, you might have trouble being successful in that environment if you don't communicate the way they want you to communicate. And I also say, you know, we have to figure out, almost like that authenticity spectrum, we have to figure out, what is my boundary from a cultural perspective? How far am I willing to go in order to be successful? And if my company is asking me to go beyond that, so let's say on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 is my most authentic cultural self. And my company says I need to be a 5, but I said my boundary is a 7, then I need to think about, is this the place for me? And maybe I have to think about leaving, because you're not going to change that company. You can only really change yourself. So you got to think about, am I willing to go down to a level 5? What's the trade-off if I do that? You know, for example, I always talk about my, you know, natural hair. That's one of my boundaries. I say, I'm not going to relax my hair. No judgment against those that do. But for me personally, it's a boundary. And so if I worked at a company that said, Carrie, you really need to straighten your hair in order to be successful, I would be like, this is not the place for me. Now, I wouldn't necessarily leave tomorrow because, you know, we got bonds and school fees and utilities that need to be paid and car notes, but I would start making my exit plan, getting that exit strategy together. I would start updating my CV, sending my CV out. You know, you're a talented person. You don't have to stay somewhere that is maybe asking you to go beyond your boundary. But the one thing I will say about boundaries is don't confuse boundaries, you know, with, I just don't want to step outside my comfort zone. A boundary is something that's core to your well-being. It's core to who you are as a person. We all have things that we don't want to do. You know, we all have our comfort zone, places where we're more comfortable, but that doesn't mean we can't step outside of that comfort zone. Because honestly, there's no growth in the comfort zone. Make sure that you're not just confusing your comfort zone with your boundaries, right? Make sure, because, you know, we can sit up here and say, well, I don't want to do X, Y, Z, 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 right? But is that just because you're uncomfortable, or is it a boundary? So differentiating between the two is really, really important.
And you write that Black people struggle to rebrand themselves. How can one go about building and branding their personal brand?
I think a lot of it starts with what is our attitude and our understanding about personal branding. So, I mean, a personal brand is really, what are the emotions, the words that come to mind when somebody says Tabi? When you are not in the room, what is it that you want people to think when someone says your name? That's your personal brand, okay? So I think a lot of us have maybe a distorted view of what a personal brand is. It's not about being fake. Actually, a personal brand should be more about being your authentic self. Because if you think about the brands that we love the most, they're brands that are authentic. They're brands that we trust because they're consistent. And so you want to develop a brand that is consistent, that is reliable, that's dependable. And so I think the first thing is just thinking about that. What is a personal brand? What does it mean? I think the other part goes back to what I was saying before. I think in a lot of Black cultures, it's more community-based. It's more about the collective. Branding seems very much about me, 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 me. And it makes a lot of Black folks uncomfortable because it goes against some of our cultural upbringing and how we've been socialized. But what I try to tell Black people that I coach is that think about if you had a personal, powerful, influential brand. Think about that. If your brand was influential, you're a decision maker, you're in the room where big decisions are being made, you could have a lot more impact on the people that you want to serve if you had that kind of brand and you were in those rooms. So when I tell people that, I'm like, your brand can serve a larger purpose. It doesn't just have to be about you. That really helps resonate with Black folks. You know, when you start talking about it's more about the community, it's more about the collective, it's more about the people that I can serve. So I think getting a bit of a mind shift on what a personal brand is can also help. And then, I mean, I lay out 8 steps in my book around, you know, and I'll summarize them really quickly. It's really around deciding what is your story? And then it's about you, you know, doing those things every day and realizing that your personal brand is everything about you. It's how you speak, how you dress, how you deliver, your social media or online presence. Everything is making up your brand. So, you know, if you say, Tabi, I want to be, you know, known as somebody who delivers very high quality work, but then your work product, you know, has mistakes and misspelled words and incorrect numbers and it's late, that doesn't jive with the brand that you're trying to build. So you have to think about, how am I showing up every day? How am I delivering? How am I speaking? And does that align with the brand that I'm trying to create? Because you can't say you want this brand, but then you show up in this way. You know what I mean? So there has to be consistency, because people are going to go with what you do, not with what you say. And so it's important to really think about that. And to know that even, you know, people think about a brand like, oh, am I selling myself? It's like, not necessarily are you selling yourself, but it's more about the value that you provide to other people. And so if people don't trust that you're going to consistently provide that value, they're not going to be willing to put their neck on the line for you and recommend you for promotions and stretch opportunities and bonuses and raises and all these things, right? You've got to have that consistency. You've got to bring that value all the time. You can't have a wobble like you can. You're human, right? But I think it's about even about how you recover from wobbles and failures. You know, do you apologize and try to put measures in place so it doesn't happen again? Or do you run and hide and try to blame other people? You know, so it's all about how you show up in the good times, in the bad times, and doing that consistently so that you build that trust, so that people are willing to invest in you and give you those great opportunities.
And lastly, what are you hoping young Black South Africans who are just starting out in their careers to take away after reading your book?
So, you know, the framework of my book is know yourself, know other people, know your environment, integrate the knowledge of those three so that you can build a personal brand and a communication style that would allow you to have maximum impact. That's the framework for my book. And my book is organized in chapters kind of along my framework. And so I really want people to take out of my book, you know, first of all, understanding yourself. That's number one. That's the first like major chapter in my book is about self. We have to lead here first. We can't lead out here first. We have to lead here. I need to understand what are my childhood issues and traumas and things that I need to work on so that I can show up in the best way at work. And I need to uncover my story and look at myself and think about my emotional triggers, the things that upset me, the things that I'm passionate about, my strengths, my areas of development, all these things. Really understanding self is the first one. The second one is really thinking about how can I build relationships with other people. I think it's really, really critical to learn how to get along with people, learn how to build those relationships, learn how to get people to want to invest in you. I think that's another one. I think the other one is just empowerment. I want people to understand, because there's a lot of messages out there that are making us feel like victims. It's like, oh, you're Black. Oh, you're a woman. Oh, you're this. Oh, you're that. There's nothing you can do. There's a lot that we can do. And I hope that people walk away from my book feeling empowered and understanding, you know, I can't control everything. I don't have control over many things, but there are many things that I do have control. I have control over how I show up, the effort I put in, the level of ownership that I take of my career, my development, my relationships. And so I want people to walk away really feeling empowered and thinking about these are the 3 to 5 things I'm going to start doing tomorrow so that I can have the kind of impact that I want to have. And remembering that it is about impact. It's not just about, oh, I showed up for work today. You know, like, oh, I get credit for showing up at class, you know? No, it's about how is this team different? How is your organization different because you were there? That's what I'm talking about when I talk about impact. So it's just thinking about how can I have impact? How can I make the people that I interact with better through how I show up? How can I make my team and my organization better? I think are some of the things I want people to take away.
That was Charisse Anderson speaking to Krimer Media's Polity about intelligent isn't enough.